genders. And I think we have also to be sensitive to that opening out of the concept of gender. Equal opportunity is something that, you know, has been talked about, at least in the Indian context, for the last 40, 50 years. We are still a far, far way away from equal opportunity. Whether we are talking of equal wages for men and women in agriculture, or in industry, or in the formal sector, or women breaking the glass ceiling, equal opportunity is something that I think has largely been the domain of men. And of course, a certain class of men, and very, very few women. So I think what this session is going to throw light on is, how do we make our spaces more inclusive, our work environments, our home environments, more democratic and more equal? And I think this can happen not only through policy, which is of course very, very important, but it also has to happen through a socialization that has to begin from home, from communities, from villages, and from governments. So having said this, I'll stop here and I will request the first presentation, which is by someone all of you are very familiar with, Professor Shahida Murtaza from MANUU, and the co-authors are Dr. Amina Tehseen, Dr. Shabana Kesar, Dr. Praveen Kamar, and Abdus Samar. So, Shahida, how do you plan to do
this? They will be presenting first, Praveen.
Yeah, okay, before they begin, let me just, you know, since I'm a chairperson and they'll all hate me for that, I know the people sitting here, but because I also need your love and I cannot over, you know, sort of step in too much into the next session.
We will hate you more. I'm not going to allow us to speak.
No, no, but there are other speakers to come in the next session. So can I say that each of the presenters, there are four presenters. No, they are three, but then there are three others. No, so six, okay? So if Shahida and your team can take about 15 minutes?
Yes, that's
together, yeah. Not each, okay? Yeah, and each of the other speakers takes 10 minutes, so that we have time for discussion. Yes. But if there is no discussion, you can go back again and I'll give you all some.
Wonderful.
Okay? Okay, so over to Parveen.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to you all on the dais and off the dais. Privileged to be here and participating on the platform of intelligentsia and unbiased people. I, Parveen Kamar, and Department of Women Education is very grateful to the organizers of this very meet of the discourse. We are also very grateful to Professor Abu Saleh Sharif Sahab, who has actually put her hard effort to bring the paper in printed form. The co-authors of the paper includes Professor Shahidama, Professor Banasitan, and myself. In the paper, we have tried to look gender empowerment, particularly the women empowerment, in the fields such as electoral politics, education, and society, and the need of equal opportunity. And to assess that, various frameworks models we have used for that, which are involved internationally, such as UNDP's model, gender participation model, gender role empowerment, etc., etc., which have been given in the significant piece. These are all mentioned in the first section of the paper. The second section deals with the political dimension. which I will present, and the third section will be taken over, sorry, the second section will be taken over by, I think, the second section will be taken over by me myself, third will be Shabana Kesar, and fourth will be Shadam. Now the first section, as there are different models, can you please go to the second page and third page? We have not made the slides at present. So these are the models we have discussed. As the second section, we deal with political dimension, where the participation of women we want to show. We have written here, we have mentioned. Fourth page. Where the tables have been given. Yeah, the same. As in all the framework models which have been listed in the first section, I don't want to go in detail, but as a crux of all these models, they have shown their concern over the low participation of women in core areas of development. The core areas include political, education, political, social and economic. Myself is supposed to deal with the with their participation in politics, and particularly in electoral politics, in parliament level. So here I have mentioned the women are very less in parliament, right from the first Lok Sabha till present Lok Sabha, that is the 16th Lok Sabha, their participation is very low. The statistics has been given. Can you go to the next page, please? In all the 16 Lok Sabha, the women participation never exceeded beyond 11%. And present is the only Lok Sabha that has the distinction of having 12% women. Though the data shows that visibility of women is much more than the male participation, the share of total contest. Since the visibility of women in political party, in politics is much more than the women, even then they are not given the opportunity to contest election. And this we can have from the share of participation. Can you please show it? The next one? Yes. Share of total contestant. This is the same one. Just a minute. Yes. This is the male contestant as against the female contestant. See, there is a huge gap. The visibility of female in the Lok Sabha is in the initial 4-5 Lok Sabhas was 30 percentage points. Whereas the male lays down. But my concern is if the opportunity and that participation and the rate of contest goes down, this is because they were not provided the opportunity. If they were provided the opportunity, they could maintain the pace at which they were winning at that time in the first 4-5 Lok Sabhas.
As they were showing their potential in the first 5 Lok Sabhas. But gradually they declined. The graph shows the decline. This is because even the political parties do not include them in their areas. They do not want them to contest in the election. This is very much evident from the number of contestants. And more specifically, from the if we see the profile of each national parties, it is much less than that. Their participation, the participation of women is much less than that. So our concern is that if they were given the opportunity to participate equally, they could have much more better chances of present in the Lok Sabha. And this is the proven fact that women are more development oriented as against the defense and technology. So if they are in the, their presence in the parliament is more and in the law making agencies is more, then they could have, or our, or the country could have done much more towards the development. So this is all from my side. Now I would like to invite Dr. Shabana Kesar to take over the discussion.
Thank you so much for sticking to time.
Yes. Respected Chairperson and my co-panelist and the dignitaries of the dais, I would just continue with the same presentation. My section would be dealing with equal opportunity in higher level education in India, specifically for women and Muslims. To begin with, higher education has been portrayed as a great equalizer and a powerful tool of upward social mobility for reducing socio-economic disparities and accomplishing an inclusive society. It is expected that strengthening of higher education system would increase access to education for women and enable them to pursue careers of their choice and contribute their full potential to the nation. As a matter of fact, education has a latent force in it which can demolish mental, social, and economic barriers faced by women and usher in women empowerment in all realms of life. Hence, what is at most important is to expand opportunities, especially equal opportunities when we're talking about higher education to all women who deserve and desire it. But unfortunately, it is of biggest challenges confronting India's higher education system is gender disparity. Large-scale disparities still exist in respect of enrollment rates, access to education, etc. India needs to bridge this gender gap in the education sector, particularly in higher education. PPT slides. I would be just going through the graphs and the statistics which I have taken from All India Survey of Higher Education 2015-16, in which I will be focusing on gender distribution at different levels. Second one. The first graph, as you see, when we look at the male and female ratio at each level, the trend is higher for males than females in almost every level except MPhil, PG and certificate course, wherein the female enrollment is slightly higher than the male enrollment. Student enrollment at UG level has 53.3% of male and 46.7% female. Diploma has a tweak distribution with 70.4 males and 29.6 females. PhD level again has 59 male and 41% of female. Again, we can see this graph also, wherein we can see that female is highest share of enrollment is at UG level, followed by the PG and diploma. But what is significant is male enrollment at each level of higher education exceeds that of female. The reverse picture is seen only in case of certificate course, which is for obvious reason is of lesser importance than the other categories. Second, this thing is female participation in different types of standalone institutions, means those universities which are not deemed universities. Again, the same scenario can be noted in this case as well. Lesser female participation is clearly evident in case of highly specialized and technical streams like different branches of engineering, except medical sciences, since majority of women enroll in non-technical or general streams which are less job-oriented. The possibility of securing a well-paid job and becoming financially independent gets severely restricted. And when we talk about female per 100 male student in universities and its constituent units, here we can see that including enrollment in its constituent units also has increased over the years, which is a very good trend. The increase is quite high in central universities and institutions of national importance. Female per 100 male students in various types of universities have also increased significantly in all types of universities except state private university, as shown in this figure. And when we talk about the gross enrollment ratio, the trend in GER, gross enrollment ratio, has increased during last 5 years, that is from 2011 to 2015-16, as is evident from this graph, wherein we can say that much of the figure depicts the growth of GER in two genders. But much of the concern is that there still exists a wide gap in the GR in the country, which is clearly evident from this table. Lesser number of women enroll in higher education due to certain socio-cultural factors, and furthermore, inadequate infrastructural support reduce their participation. The government has set the target of GER by 30% by 2020, which requires boosting up of enrollment around 14 million to 40 million. Moreover, the 12th plan also aims at creation of additional employment capacity of 10 million, which has to raise the GER to 25.2% in 17-18. And the last section which I'm dealing is enrollment of Muslim and other minority communities. We see disparity in enrollment of Muslims in higher education, as we see that 42.7% Muslims have the highest percentage of illiterates, while Jains have 86.4% have the highest percentage of literates according to the census 2011 data on education level by religious community and gender. According to the data, the percentage of illiterates for Hindus is 36.4%, for Sikhs it's 28.2%, and then for Muslims it is followed by Buddhists, Sikhs and Hindus, and Muslims is 57.3%. Enrollment of Muslim students and students from other minorities like Muslims, Sikhs, Christian, Buddhists have increased over the years in almost all major states which are depicted in this figure. For religious community as a whole, only 5.63% have attained educational levels of graduation and above of the people who have studied up to graduation or above. Just to conclude this from these graphs, we can say that the indispensability of higher education among women has been well organized. Higher education is the most vital instrument for social economic transformation in the world, as well as horizontal and vertical mobility. Consequently, it must be designed so as to address the issues of access, equity, and excellence in a coordinated manner. An analysis of participation of girls in higher education through certain indicators of higher education reveals large-scale divergence which still exists with regard to enrollment figures. So one more factor affecting the enrollment of girls in higher education is the existence of sufficient number of colleges and universities in the country. It is necessary for boosting up the enrollment of women in higher education. The RUSA, which is the landmark scheme of MHRD, Government of India, highlights wide disparities in the higher education system. Although gender gap in literacy has come down over the years, yet a lot still remains to be done in transforming this into a fruitful democratic dividend. Higher education perhaps is the most crucial factor which leads to accomplishment of Human Development Index and women empowerment. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon, everybody. मैं चाहूँगी कि बाहर से जो ख्वातीन आई हैं इतनी दूर से उनसे मैं उर्दू में बात करूँ. जो मैं बहस करना चाह रही हूँ उर्दू में करूँ. मेरे ख़ास स्टूडेंट्स भी बैठे हुए हैं और ये उर्दू यूनिवर्सिटी है. आसानी होगी हम बात करें उस मामले में. मेरा ये जो पेपर है ट्रिपल तलाक को लेकर मैंने लिखा है, इक्वल अपॉर्चुनिटी इन सोशल वल्नरेबिलिटी ऑफ मुस्लिम वुमेन. तो मैं आप लोगों को बता दूँ जो रिसेंटली हुआ है राज्यसभा में जो प्रेजेंट हुआ था बिल के बारे में, तो आप लोग सब अवेयर है वो बिल वहाँ पास हो गया है. तो मुसलमानों के ताल्लुक से जो फिर से बहस छिड़ी है, ख्वातीन को एक तरह से बहुत ही परेशान कौन, एक मुस्लिम खातून बहुत परेशान है और जुल्म सह रही है, बर्दाश्त कर रही है, और मुसलमान सारे मर्द ख़राब हैं, जालिम हैं और क्रिमिनल हैं, इसीलिए उनको जेल में डाल देना चाहिए. ये जो इश्यू बहुत बड़ा आया है, मैंने सोचा कि आज हम डिस्कस कर लें. इक्वल अपॉर्चुनिटी के जब मामला बात हो रही है, इस मामले में बात हो रही है, तो हमें क्यों नहीं इस बारे में बात करें. तो मैं आपको ये बता दूं, पहली चीज़ जो हकीकत सामने आती है, मैं आगे बढ़ने से पहले भूल गई हूँ, आप अबू साले शरीफ साहब का शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहूँगी कि आपने तीनों को इस तरह बांधे रखा कुछ दिन से कि पेपर तैयार हो जाए, खासतौर पे दो बच्चियों का. एंड ही ग्रिल देम, आई एम टेलिंग यू, टू द मैक्सिमम प्रोवाइडेड, जितना चाहे मतलब डेटा उन्होंने दिया. और आई एम श्योर मनु में अगर दो चार प्रोफेसर ऐसे आ गए तो आई एम टेलिंग यू ईच वन ऑफ यू विल कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट सम गुड पेपर, वेरी गुड पेपर ऑफ इंटरनेशनल रेप्यूट, आई एम टेलिंग यू, बिकॉज द वे ही हैज़ टेकन हिज डे इन एंड आउट. or just like a father, I'm telling you, such a good, never lose his temper, lot of patience. Only you're seeing him, you're losing patience. I mean, he's very disciplinarian that is there. Otherwise, I'm really awestruck at his behavior. 2 minutes, madam, gone in this. So, the debate, jo hai, wo debate ki baat main aap log se karna chah rahi hu, aap log sab jante hain. ये कि भाई ये जो मोहतरमा जो जिन्होंने मोदी तक या गवर्नमेंट का खटखटाया दरवाज़ा उनसे ये हमें पूछना था कि आपने कितना सर्वे किया, कितनी ख़वातीन से आपने इंटरव्यू लिया और इसको आपने गवर्नमेंट तक एक मजबूर औरतों की मजबूरी है और परेशान को नहीं, तमाम चीज़ें आपने सामने रखी तो उनसे पूछिए. तो उन्होंने सिर्फ 4000 ख़वातीन से इंटरव्यू लिया और अपनी इतनी बड़ी मतलब रिपोर्ट दे दी जिसकी वजह से फिर इंक्वायरी हुई और फिर ये कि लॉ बनना चाहिए, बिल प्रिपेयर हुआ और ऐसे मतलब एक तरह से बिल्कुल ही साइंटिफिक स्टडीज़ को हम नहीं बोलेंगे. साइंटिफिक स्टडी में ये होता है कि आपको सैम्पलिंग लेना पड़ता है. अब आप बता दें जैसे कि हर घर में ना सही, हर मोहल्ले में ना सही, कम से कम हैदराबाद आ जाते, बिहार आ जाते, यूपी आ जाते, जहाँ जहाँ मुसलमानों की मेजॉरिटी स्ट्रेंथ होती है वहाँ जाएं, ख्वातीन से बात करें कि आपको क्या चाहिए. उन्होंने ऐसा कुछ नहीं किया, हम ख्याल जो ख्वातीन हैं उनके, उनसे बात कर ली और उन्होंने एक रिपोर्ट तैयार कर ली और बता दिया कि मर्द जालिम है और औरत बहुत मजबूर है. तलाक सलासा आम है मुसलमानों में, हमारी कम्युनिटी में बहुत बड़ी गलती पहली है जो शायद आप लोग नहीं जानते हैं कि भाई ये हिस्सा हम नहीं जानते हैं, इसलिए कि हम शहर में रहते हैं, घरों में रहते हैं, जो भी उलमाएदीन बोलते हैं वही समझते. आज ये साइंटिफिक जो सैम्पलिंग की बात हो रही है, सबसे पहली गलती उन्होंने वहाँ की. दूसरी गलती जो इन्होंने की है कि भाई आपको हस्बैंड को यहाँ पे क्रिमिनल साबित करके जेल में लेके जाने की ज़रूरत नहीं, उस पर काफ़ी बहस हो चुकी है कि भाई जब सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने आपको कह दिया कि तलाक सलासा अगर एक बैठक में आप कर रहे हैं तो ये तलाक तलाक नहीं होती, यानी मैरिज अभी इंटैक्ट है आपकी तो आपको जेल में भेजने की ज़रूरत ही नहीं थी. जब वो जेल में अभी भी हस्बैंड के हैसियत से है तो उसको मेंटेनेंस नान नफ़ा फ़र्ज हो गया, तो फिर कौन दे रहा है इसका नान नफ़ा. ये दूसरी गलती थी. ये मोहतरमाएँ शुरू से ही ये मोहतरमाएँ गलती पे गलती कर रही हैं. और तीसरी बात ये है कि आप यहाँ पे, मैंने अबू साले शरीफ साहब का नाम लिया, उन्होंने काफ़ी काम किया है मुसलमानों पर, शुरू से करते आ रहे हैं, मैं जब पढ़ रही थी तब से आपको रेफ़र कर रही हूँ. आज बड़ी खुशकिस्मती है कि आपके साथ काम करने का इत्तेफाक हो रहा है. तो इनसे मैंने डेटा लिया इनके पेपर से कि बहुत ही हैरान कुन बात है, आप तमाम के लिए मैं साबित करना चाह रही हूँ कि ये जो तलाक है हार्डली 2 लाख शायद आपको मिल जाए, अगर मैं राइट हूँ 2 लाख शायद तलाक की होगी, जबकि आपको जो छोड़ दिया जाता है, आप समझ रहे हैं, सेपरेटेड जो है, मुअल्लका जो ख्वातीन है जिसको अबंडोन कर दिया गया है, उनकी तादाद लाखों में है. समझ गए आप, तलाक तो बहुत ही माइनर है, स्टैटिस्टिक शुमारियात बताता है आपको कि ये कोई बड़ी बात नहीं है. और ये जो अबंडोन और सेपरेटेड और छोड़ी हुई ख्वातीन है जिसका शौहर कहाँ है पता नहीं, छोड़ के चला गया, बच्चों के साथ छोड़ के चला गया, ये सिर्फ मुस्लिम का खासा नहीं है, ये खसूसियत हिंदूज में भी है, क्रिश्चियंस में भी है, हर तरफ है. खातून बजात खुद एक मजबूर है, समझ गए आप लोग, ये मुसलमानों का खासा नहीं है, ना मखसूस उनके लिए खसूसियत का हबिल, तो ये हमको समझ लेना चाहिए. अब ज़रूरत इस बात की है कि हमें इक्वल अपॉर्चुनिटी के तहत ये बात क्यों लाए हैं, बहस का मुद्दा क्यों बनाएं. तो ऐसी ख्वातीन को हमें क्या चाहिए, ख्वातीन को एम्पावर करना बहुत ज़रूरी है, इनकी वल्नरेबिलिटी को ख़त्म करना है. उसके लिए हमें सबसे पहले तो उनको एजुकेशन से लेस करना है, उन्हें पढ़ाई पढ़ाना, यानी कि घर में या मदरसों में मॉडर्न एजुकेशन असरी तालीम दीजिए, उसके साथ आप मदरसे का ज़रूर पढ़ाइए इस्लामी तालीम. आप कम्प्लीटली देखिए कि जब एजुकेशन हासिल करेगी, नौकरी करेगी बाहर जाके, और फिर तो उसमें काफ़ी कुछ एक तरह का पावर का एहसास होता है, सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस बढ़ता है. तो ये चीज़ें बहुत ज़रूरी है कि अपॉर्चुनिटीज़ को क्रिएट किए जाए और लॉ को इनैक्ट करने की कोशिश करें. लॉ सिर्फ किताबों में नहीं रहना चाहिए. अब जैसे कि आप जानते हैं डोमेस्टिक वायलेंस एक्ट है, अगर आपका शौहर सता रहा है तो आप उस एक्ट के तहत कर सकती है, जहां आपको काफ़ी कुछ सेफ्टी मिलेगी, बहुत कुछ आराम मिल सकता है आपको, उसका बदले बहुत कुछ मेंटेनेंस मिलेगा, जो भी मिले घर से आपको नहीं निकाला जाएगा, कुछ नहीं किया जाएगा. لیکن یہ چیزیں ہمیں غور کرنا ہے اور محلے محلے میں ہمیں اس چیز کی بات کرنا ہے کہ بھئی اس میں غلطیاں کہاں ہیں. اور آپ جیسے لوگ لاسٹ منتھ جیسے میں بھی آپ کے ساتھ شامل تھی کہ بھی ایجیٹیشن کریں اور چیز کو گورنمنٹ کے منہ پہ ماریں کہ آپ جو کر رہے ہیں محترم تمام خواتین کو کریے ریسپیکٹیو آف ریلیجن. مذہب کو بیچ میں آپ مت لائیے. مسلمان مرد کو جو آپ غلط ثابت کرنا چاہ رہے ہیں وہ بالکل غلط ہے. آپ کا پتہ نہیں مدعا کیا ہے یہاں پہ. خواتین کو ضرور, اور سب سے پہلے میں جانتی ہوں یہاں پہ برا لگے گا, ہمارے علماء دین کو ضروری ہے کہ اپنے فرائض کو سمجھیں. مسلم پرسنل لا بورڈ وہ کام نہیں کر رہا ہے جو اس کو کرنا ہے, نہ تو جمعہ کے خطبات کا صحیح استعمال ہو رہا ہے, نہ تو وہاں پہ جہاں پہ یوتھ کو ہمیں ٹریٹ کرنا ہے صحیح طریقے سے, مرد بچوں کو ہمارے ان کے فرائض نہیں بتائے جا رہے ہیں. جبکہ آپ دیکھیں خواتین کو ان کی ذمہ داریاں کیا ہیں وہ بتائی جاتی ہیں, ان کے حقوق نہیں بتائے جاتے. یہ آج آپ لوگوں سے میں کہنا چاہ رہی ہوں اسٹیج کا فائدہ کر کے کہ پلیز سی ٹو اٹ دیٹ وی ہیو ٹو ٹیک اسپیشل کیئر ایوری ٹائم وی سی دیٹ. عورتوں کو یہ بولا جائے, عورتوں کو باہر نہ نکلیں, یہ نہ کریں, وہ نہ کریں, تو مرد کو کیوں نہیں ایڈریس کرتے ہیں ہم لوگ؟ وہ مرد یوتھ کو کیوں نہیں ایڈریس کرتے ہیں کہ بھائی تم سدھر جاؤ پہلے؟ یو نو ریپ ہو رہا ہے, باہر ہو رہا ہے, ارے عورتیں باہر مت جاؤ, تم پردہ چھوڑی اسی لیے ہو رہا, تم رات کو گئی اسی لیے ہو رہا, تمہارے کپڑے ٹھیک نہیں اسی لیے ہو رہا. تو مرد کو کیوں نہیں ایڈریس کیا جاتا کہ بھائی تو پہلے مرد بن, عورتیں تمام سیف ہو جائے گی. ہم تو کتے بلیوں سے ڈرتے ہیں, مرد اس سے بھی بدتر ہو گیا. سوری فار دس, لیٹ می ڈسکس لیٹر, ٹیکن مچ آف یور ٹائم, آئی بلیو. تھینک یو سو مچ فور.